Bee here, and welcome back to biology. Do you remember back in one of our first lessons in this course when we introduced the topic of ecology by taking a look at the wolf population in Yellowstone National Park? When the wolves were removed from Yellowstone, the whole ecosystem collapsed in what is known as a trophic cascade. This is because the wolves were a keystone species, and the whole food web depended on their survival. Today, we'll take a closer look at food webs and how they show the transfer of energy through an ecosystem. But before we get started, let's take a look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to explain the importance of producers to the energy flow within ecosystems. Explain the flow of energy in an ecosystem as depicted on a food web. And explain how trophic levels are organized within ecosystems. All living things need energy. Can you think of any ways that organisms get energy? You probably just thought, food. In a strict biological sense, food is nutrients in the form of organic carbon compounds. Living things can either make food from inorganic carbon sources, such as carbon dioxide, or they can eat organic carbon molecules in the form of other organisms. Because of this fundamental difference, organisms are grouped based on their method of obtaining food. Producers, like plants, make organic carbon compounds from carbon dioxide and sunlight. Consumers, like humans and other animals, eat organic carbon compounds that were once part of another living thing. Producers, also known as autotrophs, form the foundation of every food chain on Earth. This is because they are the only organisms that turn inorganic carbon compounds into organic compounds. Most producers do this through photosynthesis, which, as you hopefully remember, requires sunlight. However, there are some organisms that can do chemosynthesis, which creates organic carbon molecules using energy derived from chemical reactions that don't need sunlight. The organic molecules made by producers will eventually be transferred up the food chain as these organisms are eaten. Even your body is built by organic molecules that were originally made by a producer. So, this means that consumers, like you and me, depend on the nutrients made by producers, because we cannot make the basic organic compounds needed using only inorganic sources. In simple terms, we have to eat food. We're not alone in this dilemma, though. All animals, fungi, and many protists and bacteria are consumers as well. Consumers, which are also known as heterotrophs, are often grouped into herbivores and carnivores. Herbivores eat producers, such as plants, while carnivores eat other consumers. So are humans carnivores or herbivores? If you follow a vegetarian diet, you would be considered an herbivore. However, if you eat meat, does that make you a carnivore? After all, eating meat means eating other animals, and animals are consumers. Technically, though, carnivores only eat meat, and humans, as well as many other animals, need at least some plant material in their diet. So we are part of a large category known as omnivores, which eat both producers and consumers. Or we could think of it as eating both plants and animals. You may even remember learning about the different teeth shapes of herbivores, carnivores, and omnivores in a previous lesson. Yet another category of consumers is the detritivores. These are decomposers that eat and break down dead organisms, which could be either producers or consumers. Many worms and insects are detritivores, And these organisms are vital to the ecosystem. Without them, organic nutrients would not be broken down into the building blocks needed by other species to survive. We've established some important facts already, that all living things need energy, and that energy comes from organic carbon-based molecules. These organic molecules, which are first made by producers, will be passed on to other organisms as the producers are eaten. This means that energy is a one-way flow through ecosystems. It always begins with the producers and works its way up the food chain. But what exactly is a food chain? You've almost certainly heard the term. Do you know what it means? It is simply a series of steps that show the energy transfer as one organism is eaten by another organism. Let's take a look at a simple food chain. At the bottom, we have the plants, our producers. They are eaten by a deer, who is a consumer, and an herbivore. The deer is then eaten by the wolf, who is a carnivore consumer. After the wolf dies, it is decomposed by fungi growing in the soil. Notice the direction of the arrows. They show the transfer of energy in the food chain. The energy from the plant goes into the deer, so the arrow points from the plant to the deer. But surely the deer wouldn't be the only animal that eats the plants. To show all of the energy transactions that could go on in an ecosystem, we'll need a food web. Notice how much more complex a food web is than a food chain. The plants may be eaten by the grasshoppers, birds, or squirrels. The bird might also eat the grasshopper in addition to eating the plants. Food webs attempt to show all of the possible ways that energy can transfer in an ecosystem, while food chains show a single path inside a food web. Within a food web, organisms are grouped into trophic levels, which show the function that the organism serves in a food chain. It is easiest to think of trophic levels as a pyramid. Notice that it all starts with light energy, so that photosynthesis can produce the original organic molecules. The producers make up the bottom of the pyramid, with primary consumers just above. Primary consumers are the herbivores, the animals that eat the plants. At the next trophic level, we have the secondary consumers, which would be the carnivores, animals that eat other animals. At the top of the pyramid, we have tertiary consumers, who are also carnivores. The difference? They eat other carnivores, not herbivores. In rare cases, there could be another level above this, the quaternary consumers. Any idea why this is rare? Notice the numbers in each level. The producers make use of 100% of the food they make. When they are eaten by primary consumers, only 10% of that energy is passed on. Then, only 10% of the energy from the primary consumers passes to the secondary consumers. By the time we get to the top of the pyramid, there's not much energy left. So being a top-level carnivore is actually rather inefficient in terms of energy transfer. This is because organisms use much of their energy for life processes and can't pass it on in the food chain. It then gets converted to heat and escapes into the environment. Do you remember learning about the different kingdoms of life? What kingdom made up the vast majority of living things when measured by mass? Plants. This is necessary because producers, like plants, are the bottom of the trophic level pyramid. And it takes a lot of plant mass to support all of the other life on the planet. But what about the top of the pyramid? It's less efficient to be at the top because so little energy makes it all the way up there. But some animals make it work, and they are known as apex predators. Animals such as orcas, lions, polar bears, and wolves have no natural predators, so they only worry about what they will eat, not whether they will get eaten by something else. Some apex predators are also keystone species, like the wolves in Yellowstone. This means that despite their relatively low abundance in the ecosystem, they have a large effect on the ecosystem's stability. And if they are suddenly removed, the whole food web can collapse in a trophic cascade, as we saw happen in Yellowstone. Another example of a trophic cascade occurred in the 1800s, when overhunting of sea otters led to the destruction of kelp forests off the coast of Alaska. How could removing sea otters from the food chain destroy the kelp forests? Let's look at a food web to find out. One of the sea otters' favorite things to eat is the sea urchin. With the sea otters nearly gone from aggressive hunting by humans, the population of sea urchins exploded. And what do sea urchins eat? Kelp. There wasn't nearly enough kelp to support the growing sea urchin population, and the kelp forests were nearly destroyed. This had a negative impact on the crabs and other small fish who depended on the kelp for food as well, and also used their leaves as a habitat and as protection from other predators. So removing a keystone species, in this case the sea otter, can have detrimental effects for the whole ecosystem. Keystone species help keep ecosystems in balance and keep the energy flowing through each level of the food web. As we went through the lesson today, we learned that organisms are classified as either producers or consumers, and that each has a role to play in the energy pyramid. But remember, energy all starts with the sun and photosynthesis. The molecules made there carry energy up the food chains to primary, secondary, and even tertiary consumers. In the lesson PDF, you'll practice creating a food web and classify various organisms into the appropriate trophic levels. Next time, we'll look at the way ecosystems are structured and define several levels of ecological organization. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.